Are we happy to learn from God's word? Are we here just to hear, or we are here to listen? You know, both are different. We are here to listen. Listen is something that is from within. Here may be just the external thing, though it makes sense, you know, but listening, it is different. Subtle difference is there between hearing and listening. If you have to respond, you have to listen. But if you just have to hear it, you can just hear it and leave it. Am I making sense here? So are we going to listen and learn from God's word, or just hear it? Listen. So when we listen, we will become the doers of the word of God. Because the word teaches us not just to be hearers of the word, but the doers of his word. Amen. May God bless you. Let's go into our sermon series, which is Brick by Brick. And we are in the second brick, which is believing. We're talking about believing right. And we have moved on to believing on the foundations. Which is the foundation? We saw that apostolic witnesses and the prophetic revelation is the witnesses that we're talking about, is the foundation that we're talking about. So, if at all we are wondering what is the foundation that we have, let me tell you, it's nothing but the word of God. Say amen.
Amen.
The foundation is nothing but the word of God. If we are talking about the apostolic witnesses, if we are talking about the prophetic revelation, where do you find them at all? It's the word of God. Amen. And Jesus is the word. The word came in flesh and dwelt amongst us. And who is that? It's Jesus himself. So when you claim that you have Jesus in you, then I will expect you to have the word of God in you. Amen.
Amen.
Can I hear an amen?
Amen?
If you tell me that you have Jesus in you, I will expect that you will have word of God in you.
Amen.
So, let me make it clear today, your foundation is nothing but the word of God. Amen. Say word of God. So where is our foundation? Word of God. So we are founded on the word of God. Amen. So let's go to the main scripture. So look at here. So now whenever I open my iPad, I need to see this. That's my daughter's work. Without seeing her, I cannot open the iPad. That's good. So our key scripture is from the second letter of Peter. 2 Peter chapter 1 verses 16 to 18. For we did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. For when he received honor and glory from God the Father, and the voice was borne to him by the majestic glory, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased." We ourselves heard this very voice born from heaven, for we were with him on the holy mountain. So we see that there is a person who is witnessing what he saw. And who is that person? That's Peter. And for your knowledge, Peter is, if I should say, I want to say it in Tamil. You know, Peter is always the mundrikotta. You know what? In English, I should properly translate it. An impatient prompter. I think I got it right. Peter is always an impatient prompter. So in everything, in loving, he was first. In betraying, he was first. You know what I mean? In doubting, he was always there. He was always an impatient prompter. Peter. So, you also should know, you know, our weaknesses. He says, "My grace is sufficient for you."
Amen.
Amen. Are you receiving that today?
Yes.
In your weaknesses, maybe you have some doubts in your life. Maybe you have some fear. Why do you think Peter betrayed? Because of fear. But the Lord tells you today, my grace is sufficient for you.
Amen.
You are made strong in your weaknesses.
Amen.
And it is this word that is coming into your lives today in any of your weaknesses, any kind of weakness that you have in your life. He says that His grace is sufficient and His strength will make you strong. He says, let the weak say, I am strong. Can you say that with me? I am strong.
Amen.
You are strong because of the abounding grace of God in your lives. Because of the grace through Jesus Christ that has come upon you. And you are strong. And you may call yourself strong. Amen. So we're talking about this one man. What's his name?
Peter.
Impatient prompter. The Mundri Kotta we're going to talk about today. Because this testimony or the witness is written by Peter, who had the revelation that Jesus is the Son of God. And on that revelation, the church is built. He said, hey, you got the revelation. And on this revelation, I will build my church. And nothing, I'm telling you, nothing, no force on this earth, no force in the hell can beat it. Nobody can destroy it, he said. And that's how he's building a church. And who is the church? That's you and me. Today he says he's building you. And no force on this earth can destroy you. Because he is the one who is building. If you got the revelation that Jesus is the Son of God. And that he died for you. No force on this earth can ever think of destroying you. Because you will be victors. Because you're the children of the victor. Because you're the children of the King. The shout of the glorious King is with you.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So, when we talk about the Word of God, when I say that we are reading a witness by Peter the Apostle, it is, how do I even know that? It is written here. Peter has written it, whatever he has seen. Peter has written whatever he has seen. So, we need to follow the Word of God for its essence. Let me tell you, keep these three things in mind. Word of God should be unadulterated. No matter what comes, the Word of God says, even the prophecies may fail, the earth may fail, but the Word of God, or even an iota in the Word of God, will not change.
Amen.
Amen. So the Word of God is infallible. You cannot compare the Word of God to anything. Because I'm saying this is Jesus Himself. Because the Word of God records it so. He says, the Word came and dwelt among us. And who is it? Jesus. So you need to always see the weightage of the Word of God. You need to be so founded, firm on this foundation, which is the Word of God. So if I say now, when we sing Jesus as our firm foundation, then does it make sense? If you're not going to be founded on the Word of God, then your life will become so shaky. In times of trials, in times of troubles, in times of test, only thing that will hold you is the Word of God. So the Word of God, the three things that I said, Word of God should be unadulterated. You cannot adulterate the Word of God. Second thing, your personal experiences cannot become a doctrine. Your personal experiences, no matter what kind of supernatural experience, what kind of a different feel that you had, you cannot preach it and say that only if you experience this, then you have felt the presence of God. Am I speaking to somebody here? You need not doubt about the presence of Jesus in your life. The experiences may differ from person to person, but your experiences cannot become the doctrines as such.
Amen.
The third thing, your sensuality cannot become the teachings. We are human beings and our senses operate even sometimes more than what we actually wanted to operate. Are you with me?
Yes.
Your senses are operating like that. And your sensuality cannot become the base of your teachings because they are called the false teachings. Are you with me on the same book? The second letter of Peter? If you can turn with me to the second chapter and the second verse, it says, "And many will follow their sensuality, and because of them, the way of truth will be blasphemed." So your sensuality cannot become the base of the teaching. So the word of God is never to be adulterated. Your personal experiences cannot become the doctrines, and your sensuality cannot become the base of teachings. So as I'm speaking from here, I'm placing myself in that. I cannot preach my sensuality here. I cannot preach my experience here. I need to just preach the infallible word of God, the unchangeable word of God. And the word of God is so powerful and it is so living. It can pierce through your soul. Amen. I've got people seated here as testimonies who are touched by the word of God. And we'll have them come here to testify next week probably. So when the word of God hits people, that's it. You just cannot be the same. So if I tell you the word of God can change people, then, you know, like last week also I said, as long as you think it is some scripture from this book, then it cannot even do anything to you. If you know that it is the voice of God, if you can open up your spirit to the Holy Spirit who can work in you, then He will make you understand this is the voice from God. And that's why the word of God says in 2 Corinthians chapter 3 and verses 16 to 18, if you see, as long as the book of Moses, the law of Moses was read, the veil was on their hearts. And when they turned to the Lord, the veil was taken away. And now the Lord is the Spirit. And where there is Spirit, there is freedom. Do you want freedom today? Do you want freedom today? You need to give in yourselves to the work of the Holy Spirit in your life. You need to yield your lives to the work of the Holy Spirit. Then you will have true freedom. You will never be bonded by anything. You will never have shackles. He breaks it. He breaks it. He'll come into your life as the word of God and He will break it. If you've given yourself to the Holy Spirit to work in your lives, you will change. You will see your lives changed. Changed forever. After that, it's going to be different. Once your life is changed, then what more do you think we're all here for? You know? He's here to work in our lives and He wants to, you know, make us into the image that He originally intended to form us into, the image of God. The Holy Spirit is in the process of sculpturing us back to His original image. He's working in each of us. But if only you give in, if you don't yield yourself, I mean, let me tell you, my God is not pushy. He is not a compulsive, compelling God. He is so gentle. And that's the very reason even Eve could sin, actually. If he thought, Eve need not have sinned. You know, He created every creation by His word. And only one creation that was not created by His word is the human being, is Adam. He did not create Adam by His word. So whatever was created by His word, until date, it's obeying Him. And the only one creation, which was the handiwork of God, which is human, which is Adam, and we have come in the nature of Adam. And there was free will inside him because he decided that he will create man in his own image. And so do you think God is so partial to say that he will create man in his own image and not keep the self-conscious will, self-will in the man, because God had self-will. He had his will and he was able to perform according to his will. And he wanted man to do according to his will too. But he wanted man to will his will. Amen. Can we shout an amen to this? How many of us understand this? He wants man, that is you and me, to will his will. Are you ready to subject your will to his will? When you subject it, then the desires of your heart will be fulfilled. Whatever desire. I'm challenging you. Because I've got people questioning me. So, do you say that he will fulfill the desire of my heart? Yes, he will. I'm boldly saying yes, he will. But have you subjected your will to his will? You will be so happy in getting whatever is getting fulfilled. And you will know that your desire is getting fulfilled. And you will also know that your desire is around him. Your desire, no matter what, you will subject your desire to his will. And you will get it fulfilled. So, you need to know, man did not obey because of there was something called his own will. Free will. But you know what? God wants you to love him from your free will. He is not pushy. He is not pushy, and that's where I started. You know, that's the reason that you was able to sin. If God thought, you know, they could have been like machines just following his commandments, but they were not pressurized to do so. So now, if you are willing to give him, this word of God will work in your lives. He is not pushy. That's what I'm trying to say. If you don't open up yourself, if you need help, you need to open up yourself. How can you be helped if you deny help? You need to open up yourself. Even God cannot help you if you don't open up yourself. Amen. So the word of God is unadulterated, infallible, unchangeable word. And we are getting based, or we are getting founded on the word of God. Amen. So why are we talking about all this? Because false teachings may come our way. When we don't found ourselves on the word of God, when we don't base ourselves on the word of God, false teachings may destroy us. Amen. It's so dangerous. It's very dangerous. It'll come in good color. It'll come in good package. But it can destroy us. And that's why we were also talking about itching ears. Does your ear want to hear what it wants to hear? Or does it want to hear what the Lord wants to speak to you? Do you have itching ears? Check for yourselves. If you're open today, I'm challenging you people, I'm telling you, you will be touched and transformed by this word of God. Because it has transformed many people and it is going to transform us. And it still is working and it keeps working. And that's why we need the renewal of our minds on a regular basis. How do you renew your minds on a regular basis? By intake of this word of God. Unless you have an intake of this word of God, your minds cannot be renewed. And your minds will be set on the pattern of the world. And you know, when you set your minds according to the pattern of the world, then nobody can help you. You will go according to the world. It's easy to go according to the world. It is easy to flow with the river. But it is difficult to, you know, do an opposite swim. You need some nerve to do that. You need something called a backbone to say no to certain things.
Yes.
Am I making sense here?
Yes.
It's very easy to say okay and yes to whatever is happening around you. For that, you don't tell me that, hey, you know what, I did that. I did that along with them. You know, I could do that, man. I was able to do that. It was easy for me to. Hey, come on, it is going to be easy for you. It is going to be, because that's how the river is flowing. Do you have the backbone? Do you have the nerve to swim against the current?
Yes.
You need some strength. You know, I'm telling you today, that strength will come from the Lord. If you trust in Him, if you look up to Him, if you are based in the Word of God, that strength will come into you.
Amen.
Your backbone will be built strong.
Amen.
To say no to certain things.
Amen.
Are you blessed?
Yes.
Say an amen.
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 Hallelujah. So let's go on. Now, we're talking about the apostolic witnesses. I want to go word by word. For we did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. So Peter says here that he did not use myths. Myths is like tales. He is not using stories to talk about Jesus. That's what he means here. He's very clear in saying, because, you know, even today and even on that day, there were so many myths very comfortably, very cleverly made. And the Jewish myths and the Egyptian myths are so great. They can make you feel reality in those myths. I'm talking about the historical setting. And now you can imagine, do you not think that you still have stories like that today? You know, our children get involved in such stories and they feel they are characters in that story. So now Peter is saying, this is not a story like that. This is not a story that is cleverly devised for you to understand Jesus. But I literally saw him. That's what he's saying.
Amen.
This is not a story at all. And if you see, I'm reading from the same chapter, first chapter, 2 Peter, 12 to 15. Therefore, I intend always to remind you of these qualities, though you know them and are established in the truth that you have. I think it right, as long as I am in this body, to stir you up by way of reminder, since I know that the putting off of my body will be soon, as our Lord Jesus Christ made clear to me, and I will make every effort so that after my departure you may be able at any time to recall these things. Peter saying this. And then the 16th verse is following, for we did not. So now he was speaking in a singular term. He was talking that, you know, I intend like this, I want like this, all this he says. And then now when he is talking about Jesus, he is saying we. So he, do you understand? The word of God says, by the witness of two or three, things are established.
Amen.
By the witness. So now he wants to join to himself some few other people who witnessed along with him. The other disciples are the ones who worked with, the other apostles who he worked with. He's joining them together with him, and he's saying he wants to make this claim very strong. So even we are used to saying like that. And you know, when we feel that our say is not taken, then we say, we saw it, you know, it's not only me. Even my wife Victoria saw it. We tend to say that. So he is trying to establish something that he has seen, and he comes to a plural form and he says, we saw it literally in our eyes. So we also came to the understanding of who the apostles are and how they were walking with Jesus and they were experiencing Jesus. Now here Peter, who was always with Jesus, he is making a testimony of what he saw. He's making a witness, and he says, this is not a story, man-made story, but we literally saw it. Now, see, if you think how true this word of God can be, you know, sometimes our minds start working very logically. We need logical reasoning for everything. And, you know, there are people who still say that the Bible is, you know, too many times written and it's all changed, this is not the original and all that stuff. But let me tell you, the word of God is unchangeable. It's living. It can pierce through. Amen. The word of God is so strong, and we need to be founded on that. If I have to tell you, can you turn with me to, I'm just reminded because I was ministering to one of our friends here and you know, some things really opened up his thought process. I'm going to Isaiah chapter 40. Verse 22. It is he who sits above the circle of the earth. It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heaven like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to dwell in. Now, what am I talking about here? Isaiah is writing that the earth was what? Circular. Where am I driving this point to now? Isaiah wrote this probably 3,000 years back. At least 3,000 years back. Yeah? But now, let me ask you one question. In your schools, have you all gone to schools? Can I see raised hands? Where we taught about this thing, the circle is, the earth is round. And do you know when it was found? I think if I remember, it was in the 600 AD, somewhere around that, or maybe even later than that. I'm not sure when it was, but it was found very, very late. And who was that who found? Christopher Columbus? Who's that? Galileo. Okay, good, I'm wrong. So you guys know the history well. So they found that it is circular. Before that, the theory was it was flat. Now this man, Isaiah, good old man, 3,000 years old, and he writes that God is sitting on the circle of the earth. Amen. You know, who made the earth? It's a God. I'm talking about the creator God in this place. And can anything go wrong in this word of God? Even the theories may change. Theories are set to develop always. But you know what? The word of God does not change. The word, because he has created it, he has written it. Who is the one who gave the wisdom to Isaiah or the revelation to Isaiah to write like this? It is the Holy Spirit himself. Because he is the one who made it and he writes it as circle. Now we are putting our heads together to find out if the earth is actually circular. You know what? If only those people believed in the word of God, they could have readily written that it is circular, and after that probably they could have proved it. Am I making sense here?
Yes,
they always said it was flat and they wanted to go around and find that it is circular. There is a word that says there is life in the blood.
Yes.
If I remember right, it is Leviticus 17:11. There is life in the blood. And when did people actually find that the life is in the blood platelets? Do I make sense? And that's why blood is given for the remission of sins. That's why, for the sake of redemption of lives, blood is given. Life is in the blood. And do you know when Leviticus is written? It's even before Isaiah. And now when is people and researchers and scientists finding that, you know, there is life in the blood? It's somewhere now. So who is your creator? We are talking about the creator God and we are talking about his word. So how infallible, how unchangeable, how error-free is this word of God?
Amen.
You need to realize that. The weightage of this word of God in your lives will change you, will transform you forever. Your life will be changed. If you just believe on this foundation, and your foundation, your sure foundation, is the word of God.
Oh, yes.
Amen. Bless you. So we are talking about this word of God. And because if we have shaky understanding, or we don't have a clear understanding of the word, then we can hear some false teachings and fall for it, because that's where we are coming to. I want the next slide. Why do we need to cement this well? Why do we need to cement our foundation well? Proverbs 29:18 says, where there is no prophetic vision, the people cast off restraints, but blessed is he who keeps the law. Amen. Blessed is he who keeps the law. That means it's not, I said it is not the law of Moses, it's the law of God which is existing. Amen. Even today. Which does not fade away. God's law does not fade away. The other version says, if people cannot see what God is doing, they stumble all over themselves. But when they attend to what he reveals, they are most blessed. They are most blessed when you get the revelation of God in your lives. Amen. Can I see raised hands who need the revelation of God? Do you need the revelation of God in your life? If you have a true revelation of who Jesus is, what he has done, who God is, you will never be shaky. And that should be your foundation. And your foundation will be firm. And that's why we are cementing it well. We are cementing it well because false teachings may destroy us. I'll read for you from the same key scripture that we were talking about from 2 Peter. 2 Peter chapter 1, chapter 2, verse 1. False prophets also arose among the people, just as there will be false teachers among you who will secretly bring in destructive heresies, even denying the master who bought them. Who? Not brought them, who bought them. Bringing upon themselves swift destructions. Amen. So when we don't have the word of God right in your spirit, I'm not talking about you hearing the word of God. I'm talking about the word of God getting embedded in your spirit. This can be done by the Holy Spirit. If you're willing and if you're giving in yourself, if you're yielding yourselves to the Holy Spirit, he will embed the word of God in your spirit. And you will never be shaken. No matter what comes your way, you will never be shaken. You need to have the word of God in your lives. Amen. Amen. I want to also, turn your attention to 1 Timothy chapter 1. Why are we talking about all this? You need to understand, even these are the days the false teachers will come among you and teach false things. That's what the word of God says. It will come in the form of attractive teachings. It will come in the form of attractive packages that teach you and that will deny what the master has done. That's what it says here. And that will bring swift destruction. It says it will bring swift. Swift is like, you will fast be destroyed. If you are giving your ears to the false heresies, you will be destroyed in a swift manner. And it will come in good packages. But it will deny the work of Jesus. It's very clear, it is written here. So are you here to declare what Jesus has done, or are you here to vouch for someone who says, anything can happen to you, and everything is possible by your own will and self, and these are days that you can become your God, all that stuff, it will destroy you. The work of Jesus, The work that Jesus has done for you on the cross, that's irreplaceable. No one can do it. And that righteousness of Jesus has been imputed on you. Say an amen.
Amen. Amen.
Are you happy that you are righteous? Do you know that you are righteous? You're the righteousness of God in Christ. Amen. How did you become righteous at all? Because it was imputed on you. It was kept on you. The day that you accepted Jesus as your Savior, the righteousness is kept on you. The way your sin was kept on Jesus, you died with him on the cross. You did a co-death. It's not when you accepted Jesus and when you accepted to die and all that stuff, you died. But you did a co-death on the cross. And this is a matter of understanding. And you, if you understand today, you enter into the eternity. How you make yourself entering into the eternity? By believing what is done. Amen. 1 Timothy 1:3-4. So apostolic council, we need to understand the apostolic council that's coming our way to avoid false teachings. As I urged you, when I was going to Macedonia, remain at Ephesus so that you may charge certain persons not to teach any different doctrine, not to devote themselves to myths and endless genealogies which promote speculations rather than the stewardship from God that is by faith. So your faith is the key. Your faith is the key. How do you even trust that this word is the word of God? And that is why we're talking about apostolic witnesses. It's a witness that somebody says that, hey, come on, I saw it in my own eyes. He doesn't want you to think that it's a logical story, it's a well-made story. He says, I am the personal witness. And we, together with some other disciples and apostles, we saw what is happening. We saw what happened on the mountain. And that's how he gives the witness. And we need to understand why this word of God is infallible. Because we are talking about the word of God which is written, inspiration by the Holy Spirit. It is written by people inspired by the Holy Spirit. Even the very scriptures that says, 21 verse 21, chapter 1, for no prophecy was ever produced by the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. So it is the Holy Spirit who has written this word. And just think about this, how privileged we are to carry this word that is written by the Holy Spirit. You need to understand the weightage of the word of God so that you will be cemented well. Let me go to the next scripture. We are cementing it well. Next one. Have nothing, I'm reading from 1 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 7. Have nothing to do with irreverent, silly myths. Rather, train yourself for godliness. Have nothing to do with irreverent, silly myths. Myths is like what you've been believing. What you've been thinking is right. God wants you to break it today. Whatever you have been thinking, you know, you need to break religiosity here. You've been thinking, doing some things, always pleased God, and doing something always drew you to God's attention. I'm telling you, you cannot force God to do something for you. You cannot force God to love you either. You just cannot, by doing whatsoever you're doing today, you cannot force Him to love you. Because He already loves you. He is love. God is love. And the very expression of God, the real expression of God, His love, is Jesus Himself. Can we go to the scripture in Titus? This testimony is true. Titus chapter 1, 13 to 15. This testimony is true, therefore, rebuke them sharply that they may be sound in the faith, not devoting themselves to Jewish myths and the commands of the people who turn away from the truth to the pure. So that is one thing that he says, the testimony is true. So rebuke people who are not sound in faith, who follow some different myths and doctrines, but that means the expectation is for you to stay in faith. And the 15th verse is so good. You need to understand. Sometimes why are we not able to take the word of God as such? And why are we not able to understand it right? And why are we not accepting the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit in the word of God? You know why? To the pure, all things are pure. But to the defiled and unbelieving, nothing is pure.
Oh, yes.
Amen. To the pure, all things are pure. But to the defiled and unbelieving, nothing is pure. But both their minds and their conscience are defiled. I'm telling you people, if you're seated here with a defiled conscience, you cannot understand my God. You just cannot understand the work of my God. You cannot understand Jesus. You cannot understand the scripture. You cannot give in for the work of the Holy Spirit if you're seated here with a defiled conscience. What does your conscience talk about you? What is your conscience saying? Is it defiled? Defiled for what? Is it saying that you're guilty? Guilty for what? If Jesus has removed your guilt from you, your conscience should not record anything against you. If you don't have a defiled conscience, you will believe well. Tell the Satan, whenever he comes to talk to you, tell him that, hey, I'm the righteousness of God in Christ. Tell him that I've been bought by his precious blood. I've been doubly owned by him. He created me, he bought me. I'm doubly owned by him. Amen? Can we shout an amen to this? So when you have a clear conscience, when your conscience is pure, I'm not talking about the worldly clear conscience, I'm talking about a pure conscience, and your conscience is made pure by the blood of Jesus. You need to have a pure conscience, and then you will accept the word of God as it is. Amen? We are going to the second point. So first one is, apostolic witnesses are not tales or man-made stories about Jesus. The second point is, apostolic witnesses always centers around the work and the person of Jesus. The person and the work of Jesus. Because, you see, apostles were with him and they always kept talking about him. Now again, we are going to talk about the Mundri Kota Peter. The impatient prompter, rightly translated. Very good, thank you, Jesus. So, Peter is giving a witness about Jesus here. Peter is talking here. Peter, the one to love first, the one to betray first. Right? He is talking like this. And we need to understand, he always wanted to be with Jesus. You know, that's the thing. He always, Peter, are you here? He always wanted to be with Jesus. He never wanted to leave Jesus. I'll take you to a scripture reference. Matthew 16, 21 to 23, right. Peter's desire is never part from Jesus. He never wanted Jesus to depart. He never wanted him to be parted from Jesus. That's the nature of Peter. You know, how many of us want to be like Peter? Come on, I don't see hands raised. You only see the bad part of Peter. Come on, yeah, look at him. He at least had the guts to walk on the water and tell Jesus that I want to walk on water. Are you ready to tell Jesus that you want to walk on water? Come on, when I ask you how many of us are wanting to be like Peter, nobody wants to, because all of you know the bad part of Jesus. Hey, he betrayed Jesus. No. Let's see the good part in Peter. Matthew 16, 21 to 23. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him and saying, far be it from you. So, see the kind of rights that Peter is showing on Jesus. He is rebuking Jesus. Can you imagine? The love of Peter, the filial love of Jesus wanted Jesus to be with him. Of Peter wanted Jesus to be with him always. He says, far be it from you, Lord. This shall never happen to you. But he turned and said to Peter, get behind me, Satan. Now see what he is calling Peter. Get behind me. Now how many of us want to be like Peter? Get behind me, Satan. You are a hindrance to me. For you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man. He wants people like Peter who have the revelation. He wants them to set their minds on the things of God. Shall we say an amen? Are we ready today to set our minds on the things of God and not on the things of man? Because that's what Jesus wants you to be. He wants you to be like Jesus, to have a revelation of him, and he wants you to set his minds on the things of God. Don't worry, if you're going to say whatever you want, he's still going to love you. He's still going to love you. Because I have not seen the way Peter speaks to Jesus, and he still loved Peter. Don't worry, you have some things to talk to your Jesus, talk to your God. Go ahead, talk about it. He will bring in a proper solution. You have any trouble in your mind? You have any unsaid thought in your mind that you cannot express even to your loved ones and family? go ahead and talk to your God. He will bring in the right solution. And he says, so when is he saying that? When Jesus reveals about him going back, that he needs to suffer and die and go back, Peter now says that I want you to be with me. Can you read the next one? Matthew 16:28. Truly I say to you, there are some standing here who will not taste death until they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. What does this mean? He is speaking to the disciples that he is saying that they will not taste death until the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. What does this even mean? Did you have question about this particular scripture at all? If you didn't have, then I think I will advocate that you will read the Word of God properly. Because I had questions and questions and questions about this particular scripture. It says you will not see. So do you think Peter's living? If he was talking to James, he was talking to John, if he was talking to anybody that was around him, do you think that someone is living today? Like a fossil or what? Are they living today? No. Then what is he talking about when he says there are some standing here who will not taste death until they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom? Did it get fulfilled at all? And that's the very scripture reference that we are reading from Peter. He says, I've been the witness. We were the witnesses of what happened in the holy mountain. So Peter, James and John literally saw Jesus in his kingdom on the Mount of Transfiguration. And they did not taste death until they saw Jesus in his kingdom. You know, even then, you know what happens when you're awestruck, you will be dumbfounded. Am I not right? But Peter was not dumbfounded. He was still the speaking guy. You know what immediately he said? Oh Jesus, let me make 3 tents for you. Let me make one for you, one for Elijah, and one for Moses. Because Peter always wanted Jesus to be with him. And that's when the heavens made a sound. God of heaven made a voice in glory. The majestic glory sounded that this is my son. Listen to what he says. Amen. So the third thing that we're talking about here about apostolic witnesses is they always let us know that he is coming back again. I want to read from the same scripture portion for 16th verse. 2 Peter 1st chapter 16th verse. For we did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty, for when he received honor and glory. Amen. He's talking about the exact happening on the Mount of Transfiguration, and he says that I saw it in my own eyes. We saw together, James and John and I saw Jesus in his glory, in his kingdom. And he says, we are not making myths and tales about this. And he says, with that testimony of ours, what we want to let you know is, with that witness of ours, what we want to let you know is that Jesus is coming back in power. He's coming. The 16th verse is very clear. Go to the later slides. Who's operating? Jonathan. Go to the later slides where 2 Peter 1:16 is there. It's there. Just go to the other slides. Go to the towards the end. Before this. Look at that. Before this. We made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. So, you need to understand, when we talk about apostolic witnesses, they always are making sure that you get this truth across. That is, Jesus is coming back in power and in majesty and in glory. He's coming again. He's coming again for you and for me. And they want to record this. When you know, many scholars also say that he's talking about the first coming. But the original word is parousia, which relates to coming again. The original word is parousia, which means he is coming again. That very word itself says he is coming again. So it's not like coming of the power of coming and the power of Lord Jesus, but the coming again and the power of Lord Jesus. They want to record that. You know why? He wants to also address certain questions that come across our way. 2 Peter chapter 3 verse 4. They will say, where is the promise of his coming? For ever since the fathers fell asleep, all things are continuing as they were from the beginning of creation. So there can be questions of mockery. There can be questions reviling coming at you. And what you got to say, you got to stay strong on the firm foundation, which is the word of God, and tell them that Jesus is coming back in power and in glory. Amen.
Amen.
Shall we shout an amen?
Amen?
Do you believe that Jesus is coming for you in glory and in power, and he is going to come back?
Amen.
And that's what we are to answer. And that's why Peter is giving a witness. When there are reviling questions, then when there are questions to test your faith, you need to stand firm on the word of God. Go to the next slide, Jonathan. They confirm, apostolic witnesses confirm the promise and the truth of his coming. I want to read from John chapter 14, verses 1 to 3. Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. Who's talking like this? Jesus is saying, let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may also be. He says, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. He says, he will carry you through. And he says, he has carried you right from inside your mother's womb. And he says that he will carry you until your gray hair is seen. And he says, even after that, he will be with you. Amen. Amen. He's gone there to prepare a place for us. And he will come back in glory and receive us back. Amen. When people were looking at the heavens where Jesus was going in his ascension, there appeared the angels and they said, men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into heaven? This Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. So I'm telling you, you are going to see how Jesus went into the heaven. Are you missing? We were talking about missing on being with Jesus, you know, on this earth. Last week I mentioned about, you know, I and Anand talking about it. I'm telling you, you will have an opportunity to see how Jesus ascended into the heaven, because he's going to come back in the same glory as that. Amen. And that's where your firm foundation should be. And that's why apostolic witnesses are so important. So now, the firm foundation is on the apostolic witnesses and the prophetic revelation. Now we've seen what the apostolic witnesses can do to us. It's all about the word of God. Our foundation is not on the apostles as such. That means we're not going to call unto Saint Peter and talk to him. We're not going to ask Saint John, like me, to talk to him and get you an answer. We are going to relate ourselves to him. The wall is broken, my dear people. Jesus broke the wall for you. He broke the wall between God and mankind. And that's how you are united back to God, by the work of Jesus. Amen. Can we stand up to our feet?